Thank you, sirs. Ladies and gentlemen, I now request Sri Suresh Prabhu, Honorable Minister of Railways, to enlighten us with his vision of a digital railway.
Good morning, friends. It's a very interesting program. Over a period of time, we have seen a huge exponential growth in the ICT industry in India particularly, but all over the world. And now, India's IT industry has crossed more than $150 billion. Of which almost $100 billion come from exports. $100 billion come from exports. So this is the largest, single largest invisible that we get into the current account. 50% of current account is attributable to this. And this has created a huge opportunity for scaling up this. I remember when I was a Minister of Power in year 2000, around that time, and NASSCOM had invited me to speak. You had Mr. Mehta, you were that time the CEO. Laura? Givang Mehta. Unfortunately, he passed away. Incidentally, anecdote, he was in Australia when he passed away. And I had called him without knowing where he is, and probably I was the last person to speak to him. But he unfortunately passed away. But I told him that time, that normally the IT industry in India looks around all over the world for business. And they don't look around the possibility next to their home, next door. Because that time, and by that time, give you an example, the DISCOMs were not created as DISCOMs by then, because the law created 2003 little later. Power sector was losing, there's no accountability, nobody knew why we are losing, where we are losing, where the money is coming from. I said, why don't you look at the next door opportunity? Because that's the year when there was a downturn globally and people are looking out for business. So I gave them an example that a young boy, promising boy doing well in life, he's looking around for a right girl to marry all over the world. And there is a girl next door waiting for him to propose. And he has no time to look around for her and going all over the world. And end of the day, he realizes, oh, I didn't realize she's off, so let me do it immediately. So the IT industry in India has done well, gone all over the world, but there are opportunities within the country itself. So $150 billion exports would mean that probably there are a lot of opportunities within the country. Of course, you must keep exploring those opportunities globally. It has to be there. That's why I said it's a current account related issue, huge employment generation, and whatever visa issues, but we'll have to keep doing that. But while we do that, there are opportunities back home, and the Indian Railways offer such mammoth opportunities. When we talk about railways, people may think it's a railway operation, typically as it happens anywhere in the world. For Indian Railways, if you talk about educational issues, railways will deal with them because railways run educational institution. If you talk about medical issues, railways will deal with medical issues because railways run hospitals of a magnitude which is probably one of the largest chain, if you call it, if it was a separate organization. It deals with social issues. It deals with political issues because everything has to be part of the government of India. We deal with environmental issues, the largest, because we have created Environment Directorate now. Energy. Railway is one of the largest consumer of energy. Water. So you can name it and this there. So very complex operations of railways, at the same time so important for the economy and social aspect of the Indian life. How do you deal with these issues is a very challenging opportunity. In my budget speech last year, I had said that this piecemeal approach of dealing with railway ICT issues will not work. We need an integrated and holistic approach. Since then, we have been working on it. I remember Mr. Chandrasekhar, who is now the chairman of Tata Group, but as the CEO of TCS, was also engaged with us to decide the framework on which we can work. And then one day I invited Mr. Chandrasekhar, who has been one of our finest officers in the government, now heading NASSCOM, that how can we partner with industry and a neutral platform like NASSCOM, wherein all the industry inputs you can get, NASSCOM will filter it to ensure that there is a proper level playing field for everybody. At the same time, it's fair to everybody. Vendor also should benefit, but also we should also benefit from the entire operation. The estimated investment is something like close to $2 billion, but the benefits will be probably 6 times of that. And therefore, just imagine, it will be a completely turnaround story. It will be a completely game-changing issue if railways can save in the next few years itself something like $6 billion of revenue, or revenue or cost reduction or operation optimization of operation all put together. And therefore, it's a great opportunity, and therefore, we would like to partner with you. On one single platform, an enterprise resource planning sort of operation, we should try to do it. And that's why we are all here and I'm very happy that we'll be debating and discussing these issues. I was just looking at the paper. There are two models which my colleague, the member staff just mentioned. Typically, we can work on a CapEx model or OpEx model. So CapEx model would mean that we invest everything, somebody will come. OpEx model will mean something which, of course, all of you are aware of. There is a possibility of a third model, which is not mentioned here, I just talking. We are organized like Chris, which is again has a domain knowledge as well as some IT. Can we make Chris and the vendor as partners to develop this? You can think about it. It would mean that you can get a lot of benefits of existing capability within the railways, which is stored and warehoused into Chris. And you can then develop it. I'm just saying you think about it. But one of the things that you can discuss when you all are here and debate it. Secondly, I was just looking at it, that is $6 billion of, or rather 65 crores saving that you're talking about, does not include non-fare revenue. I just glanced it, so one or two minutes I could do that. I think that's again, is something we should include in the ambit of it. And I'll tell you the reason for it. What we are not able to monetize yet is the soft assets of railways. We have now created an non-fare revenue directorate, which is already working on it. But the scope is simply phenomenal. The amount of information data that railways has arising out of huge travel that people make it, the one close to 1.1 billion plus cargo that railway handles, all of that could be properly used in a manner with completely protecting privacy. I would add that this is something which will never compromise. But there are a lot of non, and in any case, what are the railway issues which will have something to do with privacy anyway? But all this can result into significant increment in the railway's revenues. And there can be multiple applications going beyond railway. And that's why we need to include that, to find out how that part of the railway operation can be monetized in a manner when we are talking about ERP of such a large scale. And I was told by Mr. Chandrasekhar at that time that probably this is the biggest ERP anywhere in the world you would undertake of a magnitude that we are talking about. And therefore, in this time, why don't we make it all inclusive? Time frames are very important. We must try to realize the benefits of this within the next 2-3 years' time. I think that's what we are also planning. At least not necessarily the entire benefit. But as we go along, we must also prioritize the benefit that can come, the revenues that can come, the type of optimization of efficiency benefit should be captured, cost optimization can be done, and all of that should be done. And to do that, I think very importantly, prioritization of benefit capture should also be worked. So while we are doing this, I think we should try to work it out so that this will immensely benefit us. But there are a lot of work which has gone in independent of ERP can work in ERP. For example, we are already working on a very massive program for cost optimization of energy. And that again, the plan is already worked out. Secondly, we also done the human resource audit. Deloitte has done it. The report is already ready. You also, as I said, for non-fair revenue, the strategy has been worked out. The other part of non-fair revenue, which is not included in that, is station redevelopment, already rolled out. So there are a lot of initiatives which have been taken. And that's what the ERP would ultimately be the right platform to bring in all these together. We are seeing that on some routes, there are people who travel all the time, but there are some routes which are not so profitable, but there are some routes which are socially necessary, maybe. But even in other routes, where there could be a potential demand, latent demand, which is not yet fully captured, if you can work on that, that itself will lead into revenue. Pricing strategies based on information can help. So all of this could be a building block for a lot of informed decision making for the railways over a period of time. So data analytics, using data for management information, all of that could result into substantial improvement. So this could be, even though not may not be directly intended benefit, could be a huge consequential benefit that can happen to the railways over a period of time. So I think this is the right direction we are working on. This is one of our most ambitious projects. While we do all this, we also must keep in mind the cyber security issues. I think that's something has to be properly integrated into the entire operation. We are all going to be, as sophisticated we become into ICT applications, more and more vulnerable we become in terms of safety issues. And we always must realize that human beings are only doing this ICT. So there is another human mind which has ability to do a better job and to hoodwink the system. Because the human mind ultimately, if human mind can invent something, then another human mind he can also support this in a proper manner. So I think this is something which we must always keep in mind. That doesn't mean we should not work on it, but while we work on it, must keep that in mind. Otherwise, it's like saying that I was crossing the road and met with an accident. So one response will be, don't cross the road. So you'll never meet with an accident, so you have to be home all the time without meeting an accident. So I think crossing the road is essential, but taking precautions are necessary. Same way doing ICT is necessary, and there is not an option not to do ICT at all because there could be a possibility of somebody misusing the system. Do a better job in terms of creating a safety walls, making sure that how we can do it. And also,